and different topics related to related to how to grow food, mixed cropping, so people can learn even if they don't have internet or they cannot come to participate to our training, so to know more and short videos. So they are in the editing phase now. So through our training these past 3 years, so we several farmers were able also to sell their produce directly, but not in a CSA model, because still now it's very difficult to apply it in Lebanon. So maybe we need to find a new model, maybe more that can be applied to Lebanon. There is a farmer who he took our training in agroecology, and he has a small area where he grow his vegetable, and he have also fruit trees. And so people come directly to his garden and buy their food there, their vegetable and fruits. So he makes them like a basket. But it's not in a weekly basis. Just they come and they buy what they want. And other also farmers also try it, and till now we continue in this model.
Okay.
One
Amani,
of our,
can you hear me?
I think something very, yes.
Yes, I'm yes. Trying to keep time so we can go through all the countries. So I think it's good because you gave the
yes.
overall situation.
Yes.
Thank you. Do you just want
yes.
to say a word in conclusion? Just to finish and to go.
I just need to say that we also support in developing a community garden in the city in the city in Saida, and this community garden, which is nice that there are more than 40 persons who are sharing a small garden. But also they are organizing once a week on Sunday, a market where they sell their produce, and also they welcome other people so they can sell their products. So this is, and we are partner with them. So we create a partnership with them, and we're still continuing working with them. So that's it. We are trying, like, also there is something on doing a co-op shop in Beirut, and also how to sell and low prices, and at the same time helping the farmers also to sell their produce. By minimizing their cost in the production. So that's our main challenge. So how, because also the transportation cost is very high now also in Lebanon. So
thank you.
Also keep it locally. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, thanks. So we move to the next country. We are doing a round. So next, I think, would be Egypt. Laura, go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you. Faces that I know, and looking forward to meeting everybody else one day. We're Nawaya, based in Egypt. I guess we've been part of this Mediterranean network from its inception. Different people have joined from the Nawaya team or network. We were at the beginning working more on farming practices, but now we've kind of, you know, taken what we say, the instead of the farm to fork, the fork to farm, and looking at diversity on the plate as a way of it being a model for diversity in the farm. So really looking at nutrition as a way that we can talk about agroecology, nutrition not only in terms of eating vegetables and breaking down simple nutritional messages in the communities that we work with on the importance of how this is, why our fiber is important, how do we get our minerals, like really getting a full buy-in on why we would want to have a community-supported agriculture model, or an LSPA. We're a development organization, so we're an NGO. We work mainly with women and youth. And in the past year, we've been really active in the field, thanks to some funding that has come. So we have a project that is working on like revival of heritage foods, and heritage foods as in cooked recipes, and collecting recipes from women on recipes that are disappearing. And also discovering that a lot of these recipes had a lot of, you know, leafy greens and vegetables, and like really trying to see, well, how can we bring these back into the community? We're also doing this not only in terms of the nutritional messages, but also the processed foods. So all the processed foods, why is it important to buy locally processed cheese or locally baked breads as opposed to industrial breads? Because a lot of these products are cheap, and a lot of people that we work with don't have the income. There has been an invasion of junk foods and fast foods in the rural communities, which has been really sad to see firsthand, and really difficult to think of talking about, you know, agroecology or an LSPA or any of this when a lot of the families that we work with, or that we have been working with within the past 10 years, have diet-related diseases, or their children have severe diet-related diseases. So we're really trying to bring the full buy-in and the health conversation as part of this local network of women producers and farmers that we want to build. In terms of the agroecology outreach, I wear two hats. So I have the Nawaya hat, but I also wear the Access Agriculture hat. And we've brought in 18 smart projectors. So they're mobile projectors that can screen videos anywhere. And we have in 6 governorates across Egypt, 18 youth teams. And it's been very exciting to see that they are showing videos about vermicomposting and a lot of very, you know, new practices for Egypt, and farmers are taking this on through video. And that's very exciting to see happening on the ground. The challenges that we face is, yeah, just this whole supply chain thing, especially that in Egypt, everything is very fragmented. The lands are very small, quarter of an hectare, half an hectare. The quality of the water, the fact that the lands are so small, it's hard to control your neighbors, you know, if they're spraying pesticides or not. So I think a challenge will be to work with the people in a certain area that can work together, like consolidate some land, or at least build a network of like some of the women that we work with also farm. So we're supplying from them as much as we can what we use in the kitchen. Yeah, so our actions mainly are to get youth on board with this. I can't say I've used the training manuals yet, because a lot of the people we work with are illiterate, but my team is fully aware of all of these concepts. And I would love to see something like this happen within the women, the community that we work with. And we will be in the next couple of months kind of doing this through different schools and nurseries, and try and get parents on board with this idea from the local area.
Thank you, Laura.
Yeah, and just lastly, that we're working on educational activities. So how do we get people from the city as well, consumers from the city, to connect with farms?
Perfect. Thank you so much. I think if we go west, we don't have anyone in Libya, but Tunisia is here with Rim. Rim, est-ce que vous voulez vous exprimer rapidement avec les trois questions posées pour la Tunisie? Rim, vous nous entendez?
Je suis là.
Parfait, c'est à vous.
Très bien. Bonjour, alors je suis très 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 contente d'être à cette rencontre aujourd'hui. On prend un petit peu le projet en vol, mais je vais essayer dans la mesure du possible de vous raconter ce que nous faisons ici à l'Association tunisienne de permaculture. Alors, nous avons plusieurs projets qui tous sont liés. Nous travaillons sur les semences, et pour ce qui est de l'agroécologie, nous n'étions pas du tout dans la recherche des semences paysannes, ou d'agriculture conventionnelle, c'est-à-dire avec beaucoup d'intrants. Aujourd'hui, nous avons créé un réseau de semenciers paysans, cet objectif est atteint, et à partir de cette année, de l'année prochaine, nous allons vraiment inciter les semenciers paysans que nous allons sélectionner, on va dire, nous allons les former à l'agroécologie. Donc ça, c'est vraiment quelque chose qui aujourd'hui est très important pour nous, et avoir une pour avoir aussi une traçabilité. Donc, nous avons prévu dans le projet 2022 semences, eh bien, de créer un système participatif de garantie lié aux semences paysannes. Et ce système participatif de garantie, nous sommes en train de le construire également. Le cahier des charges est écrit, le label porte un nom, il s'appelle Nourriture citoyenne, et nous avons déjà un petit groupe de permaculteurs, pour le coup, puisqu'il
faut une petite remarque, c'est parfait. Oui. Est-ce que vous pouvez parler un peu plus lentement pour les interprètes?
Oui, pardon pour la traduction.
Pas de souci, merci.
Donc, le système, nous avons organisé le premier marché paysan, donc du producteur au consommateur. Qui est lié en fait à deux projets. Le projet s'appelle Plante ta ferme. Donc, nous incubons des jeunes de toute la Tunisie pour créer des micro-fermes en permaculture. Et ces jeunes-là, évidemment, ont des produits à vendre pour lesquels nous créons ce système participatif de garantie et ce label qui s'appelle donc Nourriture citoyenne. Donc, nous avons fait des clients. Je ne sais pas si vous les voyez, si ma caméra, oui, ma caméra est allumée. Voilà, nous avons développé plusieurs produits de communication pour expliquer aussi au public. Nous avons fait des vidéos pour expliquer ce que ça veut dire, puisque c'est très, très nouveau. Enfin, ça n'existait pas en Tunisie. Donc ça fonctionne bien. Nous avons eu vraiment beaucoup, beaucoup de succès. Donc, ça, c'est vraiment lié au système participatif de garantie, à ces permaculteurs qui ont des produits à vendre. Nous avons rencontré une difficulté qui est bien simplement que les agriculteurs qui travaillent de manière traditionnelle comprennent aussi ce que c'est que l'agroécologie. Ça, c'est un vrai problème. Donc, nous avons créé un projet qui s'appelle Caravane pour une agriculture résiliente. Ce sont des films que nous projetons dans des zones complètement isolées. Ce sont des projections en plein air pour justement commencer à intégrer ces termes d'agroécologie dans la tête des agriculteurs qui sont complètement isolés dans les montagnes et les campagnes. Donc ça aussi, ça fonctionne bien, puisque ces films sont suivis d'un débat, et l'objectif, c'est de pouvoir ensuite organiser des formations, on va dire des ateliers plutôt, des workshops, pour commencer compostage, planche de culture, et pouvoir ensuite intégrer ces personnes-là, soit dans le système participatif de garantie, soit simplement dans d'autres projets en permaculture ou en agroécologie. Donc, nous développons des vidéos explicatives, tutoriels également, qu'est-ce que c'est qu'un compost, comment on le fait, comment multiplier des graines. Nous développons aussi des manuels, des petites fiches pédagogiques. Donc, nous avons créé des fiches pédagogiques sur les associations des cultures, sur qu'est-ce que c'est qu'un compostage, sur la lutte biologique des cultures. Et puis, nous avons aussi édité un guide, aussi des semences paysannes, je ne sais pas si vous voyez, voilà, en deux langues, voilà, qui répertorie les semences paysannes en Tunisie, que nous souhaitons, j'espère, bientôt pouvoir éditer le guide des semences qui ne contiennent aucun intrant chimique. Voilà pour nous. On travaille aussi maintenant, nous faisons partie, en fait, nous sommes membres, on va dire, de l'IFOAM. Et je ne sais pas si vous avez vu, mais c'est la Tunisie qui accueillera le prochain congrès mondial de l'IFOAM. Il aura lieu en Tunisie. Et nous travaillons aussi avec les institutions publiques, ce qui est pour nous très important. Donc, nous avons un partenariat avec le ministère de l'Agriculture, qui aussi aimerait installer la permaculture et l'agroécologie dans les formations des institutions publiques, du ministère de l'Agriculture, des centres techniques. Donc, nous allons les accompagner pour ça. Et nous travaillons également, nous avons une collaboration avec la Banque des Gènes de Tunisie, avec laquelle nous allons faire des suivis et planter des semences qui n'étaient pas présentes en Tunisie, avec leur collaboration. Voilà. Donc, j'ai essayé de faire vite. C'est vrai que je parle vite.
Eh bien, c'est parfait.
Il y a beaucoup, beaucoup de choses à dire encore sur nos activités. Merci.
Non, vous avez mis les interprètes en cabine à rude épreuve, mais ce n'est pas grave du tout, c'était très bien. Merci beaucoup. Et du coup, je crois qu'on n'a personne d'Algérie tout de suite sur l'appel. Et peut-être que c'est tant mieux dans le sens où je vois que la Tunisie prend beaucoup de place et va un peu au-delà de ses frontières, en tout cas sur notre carte. Mais il me semble que Tanguy de Terre et Humanisme, qui devait se rendre en Algérie mais qui n'a pas pu finalement, peut peut-être nous faire un petit bilan, en tout cas, de ce qu'il sait sur la dynamique algérienne qu'on avait pu voir à l'œuvre en 2018, lorsqu'on avait eu un atelier à Alger. Tanguy, depuis 2018, qu'est-ce qui s'est passé en Algérie? Merci.
Merci Jocelyn et bonjour à tous, ravi de voir toutes ces têtes connues et moins connues, ça fait plaisir d'être ici avec vous. Du coup, oui, je me permets de dire un mot au nom de Torba, qui n'a pas pu se rendre disponible aujourd'hui. En fait, j'ai un collègue de Terre et Humanisme qui est en ce moment en Algérie, et donc ils sont un peu tous mobilisés sur cette mission. Donc je vais essayer de vous raconter ce qui se passe en Algérie depuis 2018. Dans la suite de la dynamique un peu enclenchée avec la Tunisie autour des semences paysannes, Torba va organiser cette année sa deuxième fête des semences paysannes, voilà, inspirée par les voisins tunisiens. Ça grossit petit à petit, ils essayent d'impliquer de plus en plus de paysans et de rendre un petit peu public cette question très importante de l'accès aux semences paysannes pour les paysans algériens. Torba développe aussi un projet de marché paysan et met en place un SPG local qu'ils sont en train de développer. D'autres aspects encore, suite aux incendies assez importants qu'il y a eu cet été en Algérie, Torba a été sollicité par plusieurs communautés paysannes en Kabylie, où de nombreux vergers ont été incendiés dans l'été, des vergers d'oliviers notamment. Donc là, ils sont en train de mettre en place un peu une concertation avec les populations rurales de Kabylie et voir comment transformer un peu cette catastrophe qui a eu lieu cet été en une opportunité pour réhabiliter des vergers, peut-être réimpliquer des jeunes dans la mise en place de vergers en adoptant des pratiques agroécologiques, en ayant une réflexion un peu globale sur l'aménagement des bassins versants.
General approach to what happened.
Voilà, c'est un peu l'actualité récente qui a réorienté Torba sur ces activités-là. Et puis, en ce moment, du coup, là, mon collègue Olivier Hébrard, que certains d'entre vous connaissent, puisqu'il était venu avec moi lors de notre rencontre à Rabat, est en train de faire une expertise sur un nouveau terrain que Torba a acquis pour mettre en place un centre de formation à l'agroécologie, à la périphérie d'Alger, avec l'idée d'avoir un terrain un peu démonstratif sur des pratiques agroécologiques et que ce soit un petit peu aussi le centre de toutes les activités de Torba. Donc, ce serait le lieu du marché paysan, un lieu de rencontre, d'échange autour de les semences paysannes, agroécologie et toutes ces thématiques qui nous animent. Donc voilà, en tout cas, à ma connaissance, tout ce que fait le collectif Torba qui reste toujours aussi dynamique et actif en Algérie.
Merci beaucoup, Tanguy. Est-ce que notre interlocutrice du Maroc est disponible ou est-ce qu'elle est encore au volant? Rachida, est-ce que vous êtes avec nous? Est-ce que vous pouvez intervenir concernant le Maroc?
Oui, je suis là.
Parfait. Est-ce que vous voulez nous dire très rapidement, du coup, la dynamique au Maroc sur la question des partenariats locaux et solidaires pour l'agroécologie et la dynamique du RIAM? Merci.
Oui, je vous entends. Donc, je voulais juste vous dire, en fait, qu'actuellement, le RIAM, il a été créé en fait pour faire la promotion de l'agroécologie au Maroc. Donc, on a plusieurs projets en cours. Donc, nous avons mis en place le SPG depuis 4 ans. Donc là, cette année 2020, on a eu 32 fermes labellisées SPG. Nous avons actuellement en cours un projet avec l'AFD et Afronet pour développer le SPG sur 6 régions du Maroc. Donc, pour le moment, il y en a deux, Rabat et Marrakech, où le SPG a été mis en place. Mais il y a d'autres régions sur lesquelles on est en train de travailler pour constituer des communautés et développer le SPG. Qu'est-ce qu'on peut dire d'autre? Donc, on travaille aussi un peu sur le développement des circuits courts. Donc, il y a déjà le marché paysan qui a été initié sur plusieurs villes du Maroc, mais on aimerait
développer... Excusez-moi, Rachida, pardon. La connexion est assez mauvaise. La connexion est mauvaise. Et je crois qu'on a entendu l'essentiel. Alors, on va passer au pays suivant, mais restez avec nous. Essayez de vous connecter, peut-être d'avoir une connexion meilleure, parce que là, ça coupe, on ne comprend pas très bien.
OK.
Désolé, si vous pouvez essayer de trouver un endroit avec une meilleure connexion, ce sera parfait. Merci beaucoup, Rachida. On va aller vers le nord. Pardon, je me trompe d'écran, je jongle entre deux écrans. Et donc, si on franchit... la Méditerranée, eh ben, on trouve le Portugal qui est représenté dans cet appel. Pardon, excusez-moi. Oui, effectivement, il y a un autre partenaire marocain. Donc, je vais donner la parole à... alors, je ne sais plus qui devait parler pour le Maroc, mais vous allez intervenir. C'est Migration et Développement, c'est ça, Omar qui va s'exprimer. Omar, est-ce que vous pouvez prendre la parole?
Oui.
Voilà, merci.
Merci. Bonjour à tous. Bonjour. Ça fait plaisir de vous rencontrer, de rencontrer tous les participants agroécologistes. Et ça fait plaisir de participer et d'être intégré à cette famille des agroécologistes qui prennent la casquette de la protection de la planète au niveau de Méditerranée. Donc, au niveau de migration et développement, en tant que chargé de projet à migration et développement, c'est une association marocaine, franco-marocaine, qui intervient au niveau du Maroc depuis 1986. Et en ce qui concerne le volet agroécologie, sur la période de 2018 et jusqu'à aujourd'hui, on est dans le cadre des activités au niveau agroécologie dans le cadre de deux projets qui s'appellent le DREAM, Développement Rural Intégré dans le Moyen Atlas, et le projet ACACTAI, articuler les communautés agraires et les communes rurales comme actrices d'une gouvernance foncière innovante pour une transition agroécologique dans le massif de Sirouat. Donc, dans le cadre de ces deux projets, on est dans les formations et l'apport des connaissances aux agriculteurs et agricultrices au niveau du monde rural. Se forment des formations sur l'agroécologie, sur toutes les pratiques, à savoir le compost et la reproduction des plantes quoi d'autre, la pollinisation, les techniques et les associations, rotation, paillage et la plantation, les semences. Donc, voilà. Donc, dans le cadre du projet ACACTAI, on est sur un territoire qui cible presque une cinquantaine de villages. Au départ, en 2018, on a fait des formations au terrain, c'est-à-dire des formations pour chaque tribu qui durent sur une durée de 45 jours. Par la suite, on a fait sélectionner des animateurs vulgarisateurs qui vont prendre le relais de la transmission au niveau du rural par la suite. On aura fait déjà des formations complémentaires sur une durée d'une semaine de formation complémentaire, ainsi que des visites d'échange vers des sites plus avancé au niveau de l'agroécologie. En ce qui concerne les femmes semencières, on est parti sur la question de 5 sites pour les femmes semencières. Ce sont des sessions de formation sur la mise en place des pratiques agroécologiques sur les parcelles et la question de production de semences. Voilà, donc juste un résumé. Je pense que je vais laisser la parole à mon collègue Erdogan. Si elle peut rajouter quelque chose que j'ai oublié.
Bon, merci à Omar, merci tout le monde. Donc, je vais rebondir sur quatre axes pour vous donner normalement des données chiffrées. Je vais commencer tout d'abord, dans le cadre de projet ACACTAC, je vais commencer tout d'abord par les techniques agroécologie acquises. Donc, les vulgarisateurs, les jeunes vulgarisateurs ont bénéficié dans le cadre du projet ACACTAC d'un ensemble des pratiques agroécologiques. Les sessions de formation sont organisées, que ce soit sur le champ ou bien au niveau de centre SIPA à Marrakech. Le programme de formation consiste de former les vulgarisateurs en agroécologie à travers un processus d'apprentissage qui permet à l'agriculteur d'acquérir des savoirs et savoir-faire pour lui et pour pouvoir les transmettre à sa communauté et son territoire. De manière générale, les techniques acquises dans Redouane, cette gamme...
Pardon, oui. Redouane, vous parlez un peu trop vite. Il y a de l'interprétation vers l'anglais.
D'accord.
Et il faut parler plus lentement et en même temps, il faut être assez rapide.
D'accord, je vais essayer. Donc, de manière générale, les techniques acquises dans cette gamme peuvent se résumer en quatre axes. Premièrement, le renouvellement de la biomasse et l'entretien de la fertilité des sols. Deuxièmement, diversification génétique dans le temps et l'espace. Troisièmement, valorisation des interactions biologiques. Et dernièrement, lutte contre les ennemis de culture. Sur la question sur l'axe de l'autosuffisance alimentaire, la majorité des agriculteurs ont déclaré que les produits agricoles qu'ils ont produits dans leur champ sont suffisants durant les périodes de l'année. 60% des agriculteurs ont exprimé la satisfaction de leurs besoins alimentaires en total, en partiel, avec ce qu'ils produisent dans les champs, tandis que 40% ont exprimé l'insuffisance de leur production agricole, ce qui les oblige de faire des trucs, d'économiser des trocs avec leurs voisins ou aller au marché pour apporter ses besoins. Pour l'axe des personnes formées, c'est-à-dire la vulgarisation de ces pratiques, le nombre des agricultures bénéficiant des techniques agroécologiques par le biais des vulgarisateurs a atteint 109 bénéficiaires, soit en moyenne 7 personnes par jeune vulgarisateur. C'est que met en évidence le rôle des bénéficiaires dans le transfert des connaissances et les compétences acquises au cours de sessions de formation, notamment au centre CEPA à Marrakech, à leurs collègues paysans. Dernier point, je reviens sur la question des ventes. 15 vulgarisateurs qui sont formés. Actuellement, 5 sur 15, ils sont capables de faire des ventes de façon permanente aux marchés locaux, tandis que les 10 agriculteurs, ils font des ventes de façon occasionnelle. Et normalement, l'amélioration de ces ventes est due essentiellement aux pratiques qu'ils ont acquises dans l'agroécologique. Et merci pour votre attention.
Je veux juste, si vous me permettez, dans deux minutes, je veux juste rajouter un autre élément dans lequel on a travaillé dans le projet ACACTAI. Et qui est un projet qui est sur la lettre contre l'érosion. C'est un aménagement d'un bassin versant en partenariat avec Terre Humanisme France. Donc, c'est un projet qui a été bien réussi et j'espère que vous aurez l'occasion de le visiter d'ici l'avenir en lien avec une retenue culinaire à la main, à Laval. Voilà.
Merci beaucoup. Merci à vous deux. Shukran. Et on va passer du coup au Portugal. Le Portugal, je crois qu'on a Inès ou Carlota, je ne sais pas qui veut dire un mot.
Hello, Filipa. Filipa Almeida, she's there to speak about what happened with the Portuguese CSAs and AMAPs.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Hi, good morning to everyone. And thank you, Ernst, for getting together all the people and managing all this event. So related to Portugal, in the end of 2018, we finally get together all the CSAs that were in Portugal, and we finally founded Regenerar, which is the network that aims to connect all the CSAs in Portugal. And in 2008 to 2019 and 2020, we had our general meetings where we all get together and share experiences and numbers and joys. With the COVID in 2019, we had to do it online, not together as we would like. In 2020, we also launched a documentary, which is not finished, but we managed to finance the documentary through all the AMAPs. All the AMAPs, all the CSAs contribute to pay the work.
Les AMAP, les CSAs.
Also, in 2020, there was a training with several AMAPs or not AMAPs, with several CSAs, with some producers from some of the CSAs related to financial related to the financial issues of the projects, so they can improve and they can see better the finances and economic availability of their projects. Finally, in 2021, this year in the spring, there was an association, Gaia Alentejo, that managed organized an event, agroecologic spring, and Regenerar was there with some workshops talking about how it was the experiences in Portugal related to creating CSAs and the things that went good and went wrong. In the meanwhile, Regenerar has been in some events talking about what we are doing. And I think in a short way, this is what we have been doing in Portugal.
Thank you so much. Obrigado, Filipa. okay, alors, I think we don't have anybody from Spain on the call now, if I'm not mistaken. So we are going to jump to France, to the southern part of France. Denis, est-ce que tu es avec nous?
Oui, oui, je suis là, oui, oui, oui. Tu peux me rappeler les trois, parce que je suis arrivé en retard.
Oui.
Alors, donc, tu avais dit il y a trois points à aborder, combien oui. on a voilà,
les trois grandes questions, c'est d'abord la situation depuis qu'on s'est vu la dernière fois en 2018 concernant les AMAP dans le sud de la France, en Provence, dans la partie méditerranéenne de la France. Qu'est-ce que c'était la deuxième question? Les difficultés rencontrées, je crois, les défis. Et la troisième question, les perspectives. Okay. Tout ça en 3 minutes. Merci.
Tout ça en 3 minutes. Très bien. Mission impossible, mais on va essayer. Donc, moi, Denis Carrel, je suis chevrier fromager à la retraite, administrateur des AMAP de Provence et du réseau national des AMAP Miramap. Et oui, je suis depuis quelques années. Le réseau MedNet, qui est réseau méditerranéen, qui m'intéresse beaucoup, sur lequel je trouve que ça nous a beaucoup permis, nous, ce réseau méditerranéen. Pour moi, ça a beaucoup de sens, parce qu'on vit en Provence et finalement, on est dans le monde méditerranéen. Je vais vous expliquer pourquoi. Ce qu'on a fait depuis notre dernière rencontre à Thessalonique, donc en dehors du fait de ce temps d'arrêt qu'a été le Covid, en France, ont été mis en place une initiative assez intéressante au niveau national, qui sont les projets alimentaires territoriaux. Il y a, à ma connaissance, 500 projets alimentaires territoriaux en France, et ça concerne en fait les collectivités territoriales. Ce sont des territoires sur lesquels il y a des communes ou des agglomérations. Par exemple, en Provence, on a un projet alimentaire territorial sur la grande métropole de Marseille. Et moi-même, qui vis un peu à côté de Marseille dans le Var, on s'est pas mal impliqué avec les AMAP du territoire sur un projet alimentaire territorial en Provence-Verte, en essayant de garder le côté le caractère rural de cette Provence verte. Et quand je dis que ça nous a aidé, le réseau méditerranéen, parce que ça nous a aidé sur deux points. Quand on avait été, je me souviens, on est intervenu en tant que réseau méditerranéen lors de la COP21 à Tanger, on avait mis en évidence, bon, c'est pas... On a fait une porte ouverte, mais en fait, que de partout dans le monde, on nourrit les populations sur le marché mondial et que tous les problèmes, effectivement, de pauvreté, de sécurité alimentaire, de migration, sont liés à ces déséquilibres alimentaires, et y compris le modèle agricole. C'est-à-dire, on a un modèle de consommation consumériste, je vais dire, qui en plus est malsain, avec de la malbouffe, mais qui correspond à un modèle agricole industriel. Et que pour passer à un modèle agricole agroécologique, l'agroécologie c'est social, il faut aussi changer notre modèle alimentaire. Et c'est ce qu'on a avancé dans les projets alimentaires territoriaux, un en particulier où j'ai pas mal travaillé.
Especially in the networks I've been working.
Provence verte, sur lequel on avançait l'idée de la diète méditerranéenne, de la cuisine provençale, et de réhabiliter la cuisine des familles, faire en sorte que l'alimentation, les familles se réapproprient l'alimentation. Et il est évident que les AMAP, pour ça, c'est un laboratoire, puisque en fait, le panier AMAP, c'est pas comme quand on va dans le supermarché, on va prendre des aliments de troisième ou quatrième gamme. Là, on a les produits bruts et les familles doivent le préparer, se remettre en cuisine. Donc ça, c'est une dimension qui est intéressante en Provence verte. Sur le projet alimentaire territorial qui a bien avancé aussi sur la métropole de Marseille, Marseille est confrontée dans certains quartiers, il n'y a pas qu'au Liban, même si la situation est moins dramatique, mais on voit arriver une crise alimentaire dans des quartiers populaires excentrés. En plein milieu d'un pays dit développé, il y a une crise alimentaire. Et donc, les AMAP, un réseau local d'AMAP, qui sont les paniers marseillais, ont travaillé en lien avec notre réseau des AMAP sur l'accessibilité aux AMAP pour tous. Voilà, ça, c'est deux éléments. Au niveau des défis que ça pose, ça, c'est une analyse que je fais au sein des réseaux. Ça met en tension nos réseaux d'AMAP. Alors, les AMAP, bon, chaque AMAP est une association, hein, elle gère sur un micro-territoire les partenariats entre les paysans et les consommateurs, mais au niveau des réseaux d'AMAP, nos réseaux des AMAP de Provence, par exemple, il y a très clairement une mise en tension, on manque de moyens, à mon avis, pour pouvoir suivre ces dossiers des projets alimentaires et territoriaux, et y compris donner une assistance technique aux fermes et aux paysans en AMAP pour les aider à aborder leur travail, quoi. Et donc, par exemple, nous avions mis en place en 2015 un réseau en Provence qui est PaysAMAP, un réseau de paysans conseils, qui permettait d'accueillir les nouveaux paysans en AMAP sur des questions d'agroécologie. On avait choisi donc de faire un système de formation au travail en AMAP pair-to-pair, comme on a dit, voilà, pair-à-pair, entre les paysans les plus expérimentés. Et ce réseau, depuis 2015, faute d'aide de fonds publics, ne fonctionne que très très peu, on n'a plus de moyens pour vraiment le faire fonctionner. Ça, pour nous, c'est un manque. Malgré tout, la troisième point, c'est pour dire, je suis assez confiant sur l'avenir, parce que nous avons mis en place une réflexion à travers ces projets alimentaires territoriaux pour faire prendre conscience aux élus. Comme nous l'avions dit d'ailleurs à Tanger, là, devant le panel international qu'il y avait, c'est-à-dire il faut cesser de nourrir la... Il faut changer impérativement notre modèle alimentaire, parce qu'on va dans le mur, c'est clair. Et j'essaye de mettre en place, et on l'a fait dans le projet alimentaire territorial en Provence verte, une idée de passer à 20 ou 30 ou 50% d'approvisionnement de la population en circuit court, c'est-à-dire avec un intermédiaire au maximum, pour éviter de mettre les multinationales au cœur de l'alimentation, comme c'est le cas aujourd'hui, puisqu'aujourd'hui, 90% de la population est alimenté sur les le marché mondial, c'est-à-dire sur les circuits longs.
D'accord.
Et donc les élus commencent à comprendre ça et j'ai terminé. Voilà. J'espère que
j'ai merci pas beaucoup. Ciao. Merci Denis. Tu as un peu dépassé, mais bon, c'est pas très très grave. Ok. Le pays suivant, c'est l'Italie. On a Anna avec nous qui est près du lac de Com et qui, du coup, connaît un peu la situation en Italie, même si elle vient de Catalogne. Anna.
Hi, thanks a lot. Thanks for the interpreters for this hard work to interpret all of us. That even we are not English speakers. Well, I am from Italy, and yes, my organization is the AFAL, but I would like to explain to you the situation here in Italy with CSA. The CSA network in Italy was born in actually in 2018 after several tries that failed during several years, but in 2018 we managed to meet all together in the oldest CSA in the center of Italy. And after that, we discovered that we are really much people than we thought, from the north to the south. As you see, Italy is a really long country and it's really difficult to travel from one side to another. And it was a really nice opportunity to discover that actually we were around 100 to 150 people for that meeting. And we decided to have an assembly every 6 months. And it worked well for 3 times, but later COVID arrived and everything should have stopped. So we moved all our meetings to online, but as most of you, it has been really difficult because it's not exactly the same, because the farming time is not the same time that the consumer's time. So what we decided is, well, we are producing new projects. Currently, there is a project called NUMES, that it is a local project, actually national project, that is mapping all the CSA in Italy. It is currently working. And in 2 weeks, we will have our follow face-to-face meeting in Italy. And we are really happy for that, because after 2 years that we are just meeting us online, we will see once again face-to-face. And the results from that research, from that mapping, will be introduced. So we will be more sure how many CSA and LSPA exist already in Italy. Actually, most of the projects are related both to agroecology and the regeneration of the soils. But in the north of Italy, lots of CSA have improved also their relationship with the public authorities, and they have local activities, local projects to include the local authorities in the CSAs and the projects and developments of the local activities. I don't know, because it has been a really surprise. However, yes. And there is a nice thing, there is a movement in the south of Italy that are linked to the lands that used to be owned by mafia. Do you know mafia? Yes, mafia, Al Capone. So the lands that have been, that we take from mafia, they are giving, the local authorities are giving back that to the CSA or to the local movements. And this is really nice, because now we are introducing both regeneration of the soil, so the fertility, the soil fertility, and also the collaboration with the society in the south of Italy, that it is a really a hot topic for the south of Italy. I guess that in 2 weeks we will give you much more activities. We will give you much more news, because we will have the results of that project that it is working for 2 years. So in a couple of weeks we will have a map a little bit more clear of the situation in Italy. Just from my side, I just jump as a surprise. I have finished. Thanks.
That's perfect. Thank you so much, Anna. You're ready for, you didn't know it, but you were ready for it. And so then if we move east, we have Croatia. Sunci, you're next on the grill.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. Okay, so we started our LSPA movement somewhere in 2011, 2012. And the thing that I'm mostly proud that the groups that we started then are still existing and the new ones appearing on their own. We don't really work so well as a network, but there are like a few organizations who are separately promoting the movement, and they are working to encourage the new groups and to even there is like an attempt to connect us all together, but we will see where it will come up. What is our biggest challenge is that administration and laws are sometimes so strict and so illogic. And Organic Farmers Association, and the main reason why people were motivated to form this association was actually advocacy. And this year we had a large advocacy action about seeds mainly, because some laws are changing and it was the good moment to fight for something that we need, because we don't have organic seed production in Croatia at all at the moment. So hopefully the next year will be wild and full of action. We are also part of a Mediterranean Caravan project, so we will have a lot of activities next year, also with the trainings on agroecology and about seeds, promoting the traditional varieties, and also starting the organic seed production. So, well, this in short, I think it would be okay.
Thank you so much. I think you have the record. You've been the shortest one. That's wonderful. If we go further east, I'm sorry, I might miss somebody, but I think we have Serbia here who can be represented. I don't think we have anybody else. So Sasha or Milja.
Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you all here. Well, we have a quite different context in Serbia. We don't have really a CSA in strict terms, but the appearance of Corona in 2019 has really made explosion of revalorization of the traditional rural products. So in 2019, we had a Facebook group forming called Small Producers of Food in Serbia, which in 2019 had around 100,000 consumers, but now in 2021 the group has around 100,000 of consumers and 100 of small producers on the Facebook group. We as an organization, Zelena Tranzicija, are now in initial planning and talks with the people from the Facebook group Small Producers of Food in Serbia to start introducing some elements of agroecology. More precisely, we are planning to maybe somehow start creating a PGS system for Serbia, and we would also like to combine it, somehow merge it with the CSA, to have to select a group of producers which would supply the consumers from the group in a longer period or during the season, or we will see the modalities. So basically, yeah, I would say that for Serbia, the Corona has ignited very much the revitalization of the rural products and the empowerment of the small producers. And yes, we are still in an uncharted territory related to the CSA development and the PGS systems, but we can see there is a lot of space in Serbia for introducing these elements. Also, by introducing the PGS and CSA, we would also like to introduce more agroecological farming practices. We are also thinking maybe to implement a sort of farmer-to-farmer knowledge exchange inspired by La Via Campesina, Campesino a Campesino movement, So we have a lot of things going on. Nothing still concrete, but we have a lot of talks and ideas with this Facebook group, and we are really hoping to start a good, fruitful collaboration. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Sasha. You did very well. I think our round is almost complete. I just want to know, because we have some people who joined us. I don't know if there is a country which is represented in the room and which is not on the, which has not been mapped yet. Okay. Then I will just ask Tanguy from Terre Humanisme to tell us a little bit about their updates. And Tanguy is speaking at the end, because actually Terre Humanisme, even if it's French-based, they have activities all around, well, not all around, but in many Mediterranean countries. So that's why I think it makes sense to have his input now. Tanguy, the floor is yours.
Merci, Jocelyn. Le meilleur pour la fin, c'est un grand honneur. J'avais préparé 2-3 diapos. Je ne sais pas si je vous les partage. Ce n'est pas dérangeant, le fait qu'il y ait une animation avec la carte.
Ah, alors on va arrêter de partager, du coup, pour que tu puisses mettre ta diapo. Attends une seconde.
Sinon, je fais 100 comme vous voulez.
Vas-y, mais très rapide, hein, par contre.
Ouais, okay. Ouais, c'est rapide. Merci. C'est rapide, vous n'en faites pas. Hop là. Vous me dites si vous voyez.
On voit.
Je reprends au début. C'est bon ? Moi aussi, j'avais prévu une carte. Mais elle est moins belle que la vôtre. Donc, Tanguy, pour Terre et Humanisme, on est une association, une ONG française qui travaillons à la fois en France, mais pour ma part, plus particulièrement sur le volet de solidarité internationale. Donc, je voulais vous présenter ce qu'on faisait avec nos amis et partenaires du sud de la Méditerranée, plus particulièrement. Donc, plusieurs d'entre eux ont pris la parole jusqu'à présent. Là, vous pouvez voir le RIAM, Migration et Développement au Maroc, on parlait. Bon, Torba, j'ai pu dire quelques mots pour eux. On travaille aussi avec RIEM en Tunisie, également avec la Palestine. Donc, je vois qu'ils ne sont pas là aujourd'hui. On a une pensée pour eux, pour le Forum palestinien d'agroécologie avec Saad, que plusieurs personnes connaissent ici, le Liban et aussi Ardana, qui est une initiative proche de Nawaya en Égypte. Voilà, donc nous, en fait, depuis 2018, suite à l'énergie et à la dynamique que Urgency a pu insuffler à nos côtés dans les rencontres méditerranéennes, une des choses qu'on avait identifiées, c'était qu'il y avait un besoin pour les partenaires du Sud d'avoir des personnes en capacité de transmettre l'agroécologie. Donc nous, ce qu'on a fait en 2019, on a organisé la première formation d'animateurs en agroécologie pour les acteurs arabophones de la Méditerranée. Donc l'idée, c'était de pouvoir former des personnes qui après seraient en mesure de transmettre, d'animer des groupes et de porter des projets de terrain. Donc là, vous voyez une photo qui a eu lieu lors d'une rencontre au Liban. Voilà, il y a Mani qui est présente ici aujourd'hui, Omar, d'autres personnes. Voilà, donc dans ce cadre-là, il y a 12 personnes qui ont été formées. Ça impliquait 7 structures au total. Voilà, donc ça a permis de continuer la dynamique méditerranéenne mise en place par Urgency. Et après, ce qu'on a souhaité faire en 2020 et 2021, ça a été de soutenir du coup des projets concrets à travers ces animateurs qui du coup devenaient essaimeurs d'activités sur leur terrain. Donc après, selon chaque structure, selon chaque contexte, les activités étaient un peu différentes. Mais globalement, on parle de formation technique pour des paysans, d'intervention dans les universités, de sensibilisation des étudiants à l'agroécologie, que ce soit pour les futurs ingénieurs agronomes, mais aussi dans les instituts techniques d'agriculture. On travaille sur le développement de circuits courts à travers plusieurs partenaires, notamment le RIAM qui a parlé, Torba en Algérie. une thématique qui revient beaucoup chez tous nos partenaires méditerranéens et qui est vraiment un enjeu crucial, c'est celle des semences paysannes. Donc, il y a plusieurs dynamiques dans les pays du Maghreb, également en Palestine, un petit peu au Liban, sur préserver les semences paysannes, les reproduire, les sélectionner et sensibiliser un peu le grand public à l'importance de les préserver. Voilà un peu les différentes activités qu'on peut mener avec nos partenaires et aussi le soutien à des fermes de référence parce que ça nous paraît essentiel pour promouvoir l'agroécologie, d'avoir des modèles qui existent, viables, pour pouvoir inspirer d'autres paysans. Donc voilà un petit peu ce qu'on a fait en 2020-2021. Malgré le Covid qui a rendu compliqué plutôt les dynamiques de réseau international, vous en doutez bien quoi. Et rapidement sur 2022, en termes de défis et de perspectives, le challenge actuel c'est quand même d'arriver à maintenir une dynamique de réseau international. Donc là voilà, typiquement aujourd'hui on est par Zoom, mais ça remplace difficilement des rencontres où on se voit, où on passe du temps ensemble, on apprend à se connaître. Donc voilà, ça c'est les challenges pour 2022. On espère que ce sera un petit peu plus facile de se retrouver et de se rassembler. On a eu la chance d'avoir des fonds de l'Agence française de développement pour continuer à développer le réseau méditerranéen. Donc ça veut dire que voilà, il y a des partenaires qui nous font confiance et qui mettent des fonds pour appuyer toutes les dynamiques de nos différents partenaires. Donc voilà, ça c'est des bonnes perspectives. Et puis, le dernier point que je voulais vous partager aujourd'hui, on a développé un outil qui permet un peu de caractériser des fermes paysannes, que ce soit sur les aspects techniques, économiques, le côté ancrage sur leur territoire, vraiment pouvoir un peu détailler de manière précise le fonctionnement de fermes paysannes. Pour arriver à faire, à mettre en avant toutes ces fermes qui existent aujourd'hui autour de la Méditerranée, qui fonctionnent, qui sont selon des modèles agroécologiques et en faire un peu la promotion. Donc voilà, c'est un outil qu'on a testé au Maroc le mois dernier et qu'on souhaiterait développer un peu autour de la Méditerranée pour montrer toute la diversité des fermes existantes et promouvoir ce modèle. Voilà, donc si ça intéresse des personnes ici, je serais content dans un futur échange de vous partager cet outil, d'en discuter avec vous, voir comment on peut le mettre en place sur le terrain. Voilà, et un grand merci à Jocelyn et à Urgency pour toute l'organisation.
Merci beaucoup Tanguy. Je vais repartager la carte juste un instant parce que c'est vraiment très impressionnant. Des informations qu'on a récoltées tous ensemble ce matin. Je crois qu'on peut être fiers de nous. Grâce à vous, on a fait un tour de Méditerranée un peu plus d'une heure. Merci beaucoup à tous. Et je crois que là, on a vraiment une carte assez complète de la situation, même si malheureusement, on avait deux ou trois pays qui ne pouvaient pas être représentés aujourd'hui. On a encore à peu près 20 minutes, 25 minutes avant la pause café. Donc, ce que je propose de faire, c'est de changer un tout petit peu le programme et de continuer avec la présentation sur le projet de la caravane méditerranéenne de l'agroécologie. Et après la pause café, on aura la partie plus interactive d'échange sur ce projet. Le plan d'action qui était la dernière partie de notre rencontre sera un peu plus rapide, ce sera à la fin de notre session. Voilà, j'espère que vous êtes tous d'accord avec ça. Je pense que c'était vraiment important d'avoir ce moment d'échange entre nous tous. Denis me demande la Grèce. Ben, la Grèce, en Grèce, on a un partenaire qui était un partenaire clé, Agroécopolis, et la situation est devenue un peu compliquée à titre personnel pour Jenny, on espère qu'elle va aller beaucoup mieux prochainement et pour l'instant elle est un peu en difficulté, son organisation aussi, ce qui explique que la Grèce pour l'instant n'est pas représentée sur cette carte. On espère que la Grèce reviendra sur la carte rapidement. Voilà. Donc maintenant je vous propose pour les 20 minutes qui restent avant la pause de passer la parole à Anna et aux partenaires du projet de la caravane méditerranéenne de l'agroécologie pour faire une petite présentation des activités dans ce projet, parce que je pense vraiment qu'on peut, à nouveau avoir un souffle, un socle commun, un certain nombre d'activités en commun, comme on avait eu en 2018, de 2016 à 2018. Et évidemment, la situation du Covid a été compliqué pour nous, on a pu se voir moins souvent, mais ce projet devrait nous permettre d'avoir un certain nombre d'activités collectives. Donc, la parole est à toi, Anna.
Thanks a lot, and well, it's hello once again. And it's an honor to introduce this project, because I know that it was born in the last meeting in Thessaloniki 2018. And wow, it's a super huge responsibility and also an honor to lead this project that will include all of you.
Ce projet.
So it's really nice that I have most of my partnership of the partnership, not mine, the partnership of Metcarbon here today. That I will pass them the word later, because we have really short time. Once again, thanks interpreters, also to interpretate what I want to say. Okay, thanks. If it was in Spanish, Catalan, or Italian, was easier, but I'm super nervous. So thanks a lot also for this, to interpretate the words that we want to say. I share my screen, I guess that I can, yes. Okay. Okay, the Mediterranean Carbon Learning and Sharing Agroecology, as I've said, it was born in 2018 in the last meeting in Thessaloniki, and it was filled with all the your inputs that we had in our last meeting, face-to-face meeting. And well, the partnership that this constitutes this project is for 6 countries. Originally, it was 7, but as Jocelyn has said, we had some difficulties with, Greece had some difficulties at the end, and we hope that they will come back as soon as possible. And this is our map we have in common, our sea, the Mediterranean, as you all. So here we are, the Mediterranean Basin. Italy, Turkey, Serbia, Croatia, Portugal, and France, that include all of you. And we are really, really happy to have all the Mediterranean Basin included through the international network. The objectives of MedCaravan are to support rural communities, social inclusion throughout the learning and the valorization and empower of local knowledge. And this is, I guess, the key objective of MedCaravan, the valorization and empowerment of the local knowledge, as you have explained right now in this round of introduction of ourselves, that we are giving to the basin, we are giving to the whole network all our local knowledge. That is what we wanted to approach in this project, is a bottom-up approach project. So it is not an academia project, but the knowledge and the experience sharing are coming from the locals and are coming from the rural communities. Then another objective is to mainstream agroecological practices in small scale agriculture as a means to support rural livelihoods, while at the same time fostering climate resilience and environmental sustainability. So what we want is to improve and to valorize all these local knowledges that we have in small scale agriculture. And to take into consideration the climate resilience and environmental sustainability that we have, that it is in common for all our countries in the Mediterranean Basin. We are all facing the same, more or less the same difficulties with the climate. And then build innovation and capacities by enhancing technical as well as organizational skill of partners and target groups. Well, it means that we will have a super cool participatory digital platform that will include also your knowledge and will be in contact for all of us. The project started officially in October 20, but it was just officially because we had some COVID problems, and we will finish in 2023. We are focusing basically for adult learners and for food communities. It means that we are not just targeting just farmers, but the whole food community. So including farmers, consumers, interpreters, whoever are included in the food community. we have three intellectual outputs. The first one is the best practice guide for collecting agroecological knowledge. That it means that we are producing a guideline of how to collect for non-academia people, for non-official researchers, how to collect the agroecological knowledge from the fields. As Laura from Navaya, sorry if I didn't know how to pronounce it, said before with the participatory videos, we are identifying also other methods of actual research to look for the knowledge that is in our local communities, in our rural communities, but not for academia. This is an important thing because we want a peer-to-peer research and a bottom-up research. Then we will have this online carbon platform that it will be a participatory platform where we will host and we will allow you to upload the knowledge, the tools, the experiences that you have in your fields in the Mediterranean basin, so focusing in the Mediterranean basin. And we will share also the outputs that we are producing. And the best thing is that all the outputs that we are producing will be translated into all our the partnership languages and also into Arabic. Okay, so maybe for most of us it would be also easier to get it. Well, I know that French and English are easier, but I think it's also nice to have it into Arabic. And then we will have once again an educational program of learning on agroecology and the Mediterranean that we use in the agroecology, sorry, that we use in the Mediterranean basin. But we are defining the Mediterranean basin. We are defining the agroecology, the curriculum through your experiences. So it will be not agroecology that is built from up bottom, so we say that you have to do like this, but we want to valorize the collection of knowledge that we have collected in intellectual output one and to put it into a curriculum that we will valorize both the local knowledge and also the innovation research that universities or civil organizations or yourselves are doing in the fields. We will have several activities, as some of us has already explained. We will have the first training event that hopefully we will have it in March 2022 in Serbia, that we will train staff and members of our organizations. And some of you will be invited also to join this training to have and to empower us with action research, with participatory tools to make to collect this knowledge from the fields. Then we will have another transnational training event that will be in October 22, hopefully in Italy. And here it will be open to more people and we will share how we train agroecology in our countries. Once again, I hope that you are also invited to join this training. And in this training, we will share that the methodology and the contents that we transmit during our agroecology trainings in our own countries. We will have three local multiplier events. So each partner country will develop the first one. So we, in the first multiplier event, we will collect the local knowledge that are in our countries that will be included in the curriculum. Then we will have local trainings on agroecology. So we will identify the best practices for agroecology and for training in agroecology. And the last one, it is a dissemination event that will be hosted in each partner country to disseminate the results of our project. And also you will be invited to our events, so you can take the information once again from the experience of MedCaravan and spread the voice in your country. So we'll have a higher impact in the Mediterranean country, and you also will be enriched with the results of MedCaravan, that is a project that has built from all of us. We have this roadmap that I really love, but not a lot of people understand it, but this is a sound of mind map of the project, so you can understand the project a little bit easier just following the arrows. But I don't take more time to explain it because it is what we have said, the three outputs and the events that are linked to the outputs and how you will be also involved. And well, what we wanted to say is that the MedCaravan project is a project that is that we want to gather people's knowledge by people and for people. So it is really a bottom-up approach that we really want to meet each other, to exchange and share information on agroecology and how we train on agroecology and which are the needs, specifically needs that we have in the Mediterranean basin, because we have in common not just the sea, but also the climate change that is getting really strong, that our soils are desertifying, that we are losing our water, that we are losing our fertilities, how which kind of methods we are using to save our farming and to save also our community, our rural communities. What we have identified four main topics that are more or less the four topics that we have on agroecology, that are the farming practices, which kind of farming practices we used in our countries that most probably are more or less the same, but we don't want the farming practices that are bringing the big industry or also neither the academia, but we want the practices that are being used real for the real communities, for the real farmers in their fields. Also improving the best practices that are coming from the knowledge, from the academia knowledge as well. Then we have another big issue, that is the financial sustainability. As most of you have already said, how we can survive, how we can face the local farming, how we can support the local farming and to make accessible the that food, the local food and organic food to people who have low incomes, and also how to farmers can survive in this war against industrial agriculture, because the junk food is obviously cheaper than ours, but we don't want to lose. We want to at least to live and win somehow. Then the social dimension, which are the characteristics that defines our Mediterranean basin in agroecology, which are the main characteristics, how we are related, how we are connected to agroecology, and then the links that we have with the public policies. If any one of you, some of you have already explained that you have some partnerships with the ministers, or with the local authorities, so we can support also the smaller scale farming activities and practices, and also the rural communities. So which supports do we have from the authorities? Okay, so it has been a really fast overview of the Mediterranean caravan, and well, I will pass the ball once again to my partners, to my partnerships that are, well, I just want to give you a quick round of presentations who are urgency that you already know. Sasha and Milja from Serbia, Ines and Carlota from Portugal, Sunci from from Croatia. We have also Bugdai from Turkey, but they are not here, and me from Italy. And I guess that we are not losing any other people. No, I think that we are all here. And well, the rest of you through urgency. So urgency is not representing themselves, but is representing you. So thanks a lot. And well.
Thank you, Anna. That's perfect. Ready. We have a couple of minutes before the break, so why don't we introduce already like the interactive part we want to do, and we will come back after the break to actually do it if you want. I don't know if it's Sasha or Anna who is going to introduce like the idea how we want to organize that part, because basically the key idea is to identify like how the MedNet people and organizations can get involved into this project. The idea is really to support the Mediterranean network. So we need to identify your needs and also what you can offer to us, exactly as Anna said. And maybe I leave you the floor now, Sasha. I have something to share actually with you. I'm just concern I would forget if I don't do it immediately. So I will do it very shortly. I want to tell you that a lot of the things we touched upon today can be found on Urgency website. We have a new website, and I just want to share my screen for just a second, telling you that we have on our website, we have this map, interactive map, and you can go and you see, for example, in Palestine, then you click and you have an article about the situation of CSA in Palestine. You have a report about the MedNet meeting that happened in Turkey. You click on it and then you go to the to this thing. And we also have the report we did about the situation in the Mediterranean countries. The data is from 2016, but still it can be interesting for you. We have most of the countries which are represented today, which are mapped there. That was really like just an input to be sure I'm not forgetting. Now, about the interactive games, Asha, if you want to introduce it, and then we come back after the coffee break to do it.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Jocelyn. As I already explained in the chat, the idea is that we have two sections. One is focused on the what can we offer, what is our strong points in sense of knowledge, and what type of knowledge do we have as a need, each organization of ours. So that is one section. The other section is related to the trainings. So also, what can we offer as a knowledge for the training, and the knowledge we would like to obtain on certain training. So the topics are divided in farming practices, as you can see, financial sustainability, social dimension of agroecology, and public policy. So the idea is that each of you here present writes the topics on the mirror board related to knowledge collection. Which topics can you share knowledge, and which topics do you need knowledge? As the same thing for the trainings, which topics are a strong point to share on the training, and on which topics would you need a training to obtain a certain knowledge? So basically, that is the idea. I think it's quite simple. I hope so.
I have a question, proposition. Is it maybe good that we explain, as Sasha did, the chart in detail if there are any questions? And maybe people have a coffee break and think about what they will put on
yes,
this chart so that we don't do it in rush.
And maybe something that comes from previous sessions. Some people are not fluent with Miro. It can be difficult. So it's possible also for them to speak, and we can take note for them on the Miro. Milia. Yeah.
Yes. Or is it also possible to write it in chat, or is that too chaotic in?
No, it's also completely possible in English or French. Yeah.
Yes.
So do you want to go through the different topics again, or to re-explain them, Milia, or did I misunderstand?
No, only if someone has questions. I think that in general, Sasha explained how the chart works.
So please, any question?
Otherwise, sorry for this, but otherwise, after the break, we can have a short review of the activities, because Inés and Carlota were preparing a sort of interaction with you for introducing once again the question. So maybe we can think a little bit about that. Okay, Inés.
Thank you, Anna. No, I think that maybe now we should have a break. We should have a coffee and spread our legs, and then we will be very happy to hear what you have to say and what can we do together, because it was really a beautiful session before. We learned so much with you all. So I think that afterwards we can a little bit talk a little bit and see what Rim has to say and Marcia and everyone about where can we have some knowledge sharing and collection together. Okay.
Perfect. So actually we are right on time, 1 minute before the schedule. I mean, not perhaps regarding all what we are supposed to do, but at least regarding the break. And so the interpreters are going to change. So I think we can thank again those who have been with us today. I mean, for this first part of the session. I don't know if Elise is going to stay with us or Cathy, but thank you to both anyway. And so we really take a short break and we make sure we are back at noon, really just 15 minutes. Please be back on time. Revenez à temps. On prend juste 15 minutes de pause café. Merci à tous. À tout de suite.
Thank you. Saber da terra raiz é riqueza de... de nourrir. Tucunaré e beira de rio. Espelha no rio, tudo é cué, tucunaré e beira de rio. O nosso recado é: venha para a Amazônia e ouça, muito se fala.
Here we go. Let me check. And do we have interpretation in French?
French. Est-ce qu'on a de l'interprétation en français?
Oui, est-ce que vous m'entendez tout?
Oui. J'entends tout le monde. Parfait. Okay. So as we said, we have now interactive parts, and actually it's up to you to come in with your inputs. Your ideas, and I will leave the floor to whoever is supposed to manage this part. I don't know if it's Ines, right?
Oh, it's a teamwork, it's as we do everything in the Met Caravan. So I think that Sasha could share the screen, right? For everybody to see. And we saw that...
Sorry, Amani, yes.
sharing the screen of Miro, you think, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Adines, sorry, how much time do you need for this?
How much time can you give us?
Half an hour, is it okay, or is it too short?
No, I think it's okay.
Perfect.
Yeah, so we would like to, just to explain a little bit better. So we have here the mural and we have like two columns like Sasha and Anna and Justine have already mentioned. So the knowledge collection, and in there, we would like that you to put the name of your institution in the thematic area that you could help us work on. And then in training, and we saw that Amani has already fulfilled with the in the training. So for the thematic area farming practices, Amani has already identified. Amani, are you there?
Yes. Yeah, I am here.
Yeah. So can you explain so that everybody can understand what was your idea when fulfilling the board, the mirror board?
Yeah. So concerning the training table, about the training table, you mean?
Or yeah.
The two? Okay, so we feel as in the association, through our experience and farming practices, especially in agroecology, that we can help and we can give training in this topic. But we need a lot of knowledge and tools about the three others, especially the sustainability of the farm. Especially when Marcia was talking about how we can at the same time create find a middle between how farmers can be sustainable in selling their products, and at the same time consumers can afford to buy their products. So this, especially in our situation now in Lebanon, so we feel, we tried a bit about the CSA, but it didn't work till now. And during the COVID, a lot of people farmers, small scale farmers succeed in the delivery. So they had a lot of people, they were able to sell their produce through the delivery, especially in the COVID because there was the lockdown. But after that, when the economic crisis in Lebanon started, their selling reduced a lot, because people cannot afford anymore to buy their produce because it's a bit expensive. So we started to give it more training about practices, agroecology, so the farmers can reduce their cost, so they can maybe sell a bit less and a bit like the local market. And also we would like to know more about how to build the connection between the farmers and the community, but especially with the customers, how to do the meetings, how to what are the different tools, a bit more training about that.
Thank you so much. And how about knowledge collection? Can you provide us with some of your skills, or do you need anything from us regarding knowledge collection?
Yeah, I thought I already feel it. I can give about about the farming practices, and I need some knowledge for the three others below. So yeah, I thought that I feel it also.
Okay. We are just starting. Thank you so much, okay. Amani. Carlota.
I don't know if anyone else has filled in the mirror board. I don't think so. I have shared
their ideas in the chat, but from our previous presentations, I can say that, for example, Laura from Egypt, Nawaya, I think you said, Laura, that you've been collecting knowledge from the fields, working with rural women. I think that would be also very useful for Med Caravan. You've also worked, we have educational programs with youth, and I think that would be useful for us as well in regards to educational programs. And I don't know if you would like to share in regards to training your needs, or if there's anything, any other topics that you could offer knowledge to the Med Caravan. I don't know if Laura, are you still
there?
Yeah,
okay. It's just that the boxes are hard for me to position myself in.
Yeah.
Sorry, I get the point of the exercise, but if I talk about, you know, the tools that we use to have women meet and dig up old recipes, because, you know, if you talk about certain things, sometimes it doesn't come in the first time, it comes after several times. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a process, but I don't know if that would fit under farming practices, because, you know, that's not really it. So yeah, I and the same thing with farming practices in terms of knowledge collection. The work that I do with Access Agriculture is about farmer to farmer knowledge and how to write scripts and how to interview farmers and how to mm-hmm. get the best, you know. So I've been doing this for a long time, so in terms of farming practices or collective practices on the video side specifically, mm-hmm. like interview skills, scripting, preparing for, yeah, that kind of farmer to farmer media. And I'm doing the same thing with the recipes. So I film women talk about nutrition of recipes and the recipes themselves. I can share the link with you guys. And then we screen the videos in a community setting. So the watching the videos together helps stimulate a discussion. So we're using media in the videos. Mm-hmm. And for the youth, we're going to be doing our first PRA with them over the next month. So understanding the community and then trying to tailor it to the needs of our work and our projects. So that we really want our project to be sustainable locally. So mm-hmm. the financial system, or like looking at the solidarity economy, like we don't want to depend on just people from Cairo or just, you know, class mm-hmm. A type clients. So we decided to do a PRA and just go back again, collecting data, just that, you know, because that's the only tool we know how to, you know, that would offer us a kind of map of the services and understand what's needed. So yeah, sorry if I haven't filled it in, because I was looking at it and waiting to see what people would, yeah.
You can also write in the chat, and Sasha and Media, they are doing that,
put it together.
helping work. Reem.
And just this question, clarification question for public policies on agroecology. Can somebody give me an example of how this would differ in terms of knowledge collection and training?
Anna, do you want to answer?
Well, actually, what we wanted to face with this thing is that we have seen that we cannot do in lots of countries or in lots of situations that we are really linked to the public policies or to the public authorities if they allow us to do some kind of things. And it is a sort of tools or helps that we need or that they can receive to interact with this kind of authorities. So we are not just working inside the rural community, but also interacting with the authorities or sort of politicians somehow. But it is a topic for most of the partnership. They wanted to face also these aspects. Also, for example, regarding advocacy, what means advocacy? What means to create a campaign regarding agroecology and rural communities? So link the politic and the action. Once again, we have to tell the truth, it's a really small section from this, because we are facing other things, but this is real. We need to face also the advocacy and the relationship with policies.
Thank you.
Reem, do you want to speak?
Je veux bien. Alors, je vais essayer de dire ce que nous pouvons faire, là où les choses sur lesquelles on est pas mal, c'est la création d'événements qui évidemment est liée au plaidoyer, à la sensibilisation aussi, grand public, puisque nous organisons depuis 6 ans maintenant une fête qui prend de l'ampleur. Hein, la dernière fête des semences paysannes, elle a accueilli 2700 personnes pendant 2 jours. Donc, tout ce qui est comment organiser, comment communiquer, comment, quelles sont la programmation à mettre en place, on est année après année un peu meilleur que l'année précédente. Et cette année, nous organisons au printemps, après le Ramadan, nous organisons, si tout va bien, une convergence de permaculteurs en Tunisie. Voilà, donc c'est la première fois que nous allons faire ça et nous avons un process qui est, nous faisons ça en camping pour que tout le monde puisse venir. On met toujours en place des choses qui ne coûtent pas beaucoup d'argent et ça, ça marche toujours très, très bien. Donc, quand je dis événement, nous organisons aussi des formations gratuites, aussi pareilles en camping pour qu'un maximum de personnes puissent venir. Donc, vraiment là-dessus, on peut vraiment apporter des choses de l'organisation d'événements publics autour de l'agroécologie et de la permaculture. Là où vraiment on est en manque, alors bien sûr aussi tout ce qui est plaidoyer, hein, puisque nous avons un impact quand même, nous avons réussi à avoir un impact, plusieurs résultats très intéressants. On a eu un timbre de la Poste sur la souveraineté alimentaire et les semences paysannes. On a réussi à avoir des partenariats avec des institutions publiques et vraiment le travail de plaidoyer avec les politiques aujourd'hui, avec les institutions publiques. Là-dessus aussi, on peut vraiment contribuer à ça. Pendant le corona, tout de suite, nous avons écrit un appel pour une agriculture résiliente et c'est un appel qui a été signé par une cinquantaine d'institutions et de personnalités publiques que nous avons déposé au ministère de l'Agriculture, à la présidence du gouvernement, aux institutions publiques, et que ça a eu un écho. Voilà, donc tout ce qui est travail de plaidoyer et puis voilà, d'impact, parce que nous sommes assez médiatisés, hein, tout ce qui est communication, on est connus aujourd'hui en Tunisie. Donc ça, c'est bien, on est content là-dessus, mais c'est vrai qu'il faut tout le temps, en fait, il ne faut jamais se faire oublier. Voilà, ça, on a compris. On est toujours dans des activités, toujours dans le partage d'informations, tout le temps. Donc, ça, c'est et comme ça, on ne nous oublie pas. Voilà, donc là-dessus, on peut aussi contribuer, apporter des choses. Alors, évidemment, tout ce qui est développement de formation, de partage de connaissances, donc ça, évidemment, aussi, sur le milieu aride, essentiellement, aussi, puisque nous sommes un pays qui est dans le top mondial des pays qui ont un stress hydrique très important aussi. Donc, on essaye de développer vraiment des techniques liées au stress hydrique et au manque d'eau, donc vraiment en milieu aride. Et puis aussi, ceux sur lesquels on est vraiment moins fort parce qu'on n'a pas encore réussi à trouver comment travailler, c'est vraiment le jeune public. Les enfants. Donc ça, on aimerait beaucoup travailler sur le jeune public. On a mis en place un potager communautaire avec des enfants. Mais je pense qu'il nous faut vraiment encore quelque chose de plus... on y va à l'instinct, pour l'instant, mais on n'est pas adapté quoi, pour le jeune public encore. On est bien pour le public agriculteur et adultes, on va dire, urbains, néo-ruraux et agriculteurs, et personnes et agriculteurs anciens en termes d'âge, voilà, mais vraiment pas très bon avec le jeune public. Donc ça, on a vraiment un besoin. Et puis aussi développer des modèles économiques des fermes.
Merci beaucoup.
C'est essentiel. Voilà.
Merci. Flipa. Flipa Maida, estás ahí.
Sí. Thank so you. I think we need a lot of stuff. But the main ones that my head was fixed in related to the experiences of the CSAs that I've been engaged. I think, I'm sorry, I'm not able to write on Miro, so I will say through here. Related to farming practices, the soil's fertility, it's something that it's a question in among the producers. How to promote more fertility, how to work with some techniques. So sharing knowledge about that, it would be great. Also, water management, how to retain water in the soils, how to deal better with this situation in Mediterranean related to the water, because it is getting really, really hard, mainly in Alentejo. Related to the social dimension, there are two questions that we talk a lot in Regenerar, in the network of the CSAs. One is how to reach the rural people, how to bring rural people to, mainly in Portugal. I don't know how it is in other countries, but in Portugal, we have a lot of agroecologic practices in the rural countries, but they never heard about agroecology. They don't know what is this. So how can we approach to them, and how can we make them close to agroecology concepts? So I think this is really interesting, and how can we do it? Also in the social dimension, this is a $1 million question. How can we how can we deal better with consumers? Like, how can we attract more people to these practices? But at the same way, attracting them, but how can I say this? Because in Porto, the CSA in Porto, somehow it looks like a supermarket. People, they are not active, they are not engaged with the CSA. They just go there, they pick the basket, and then they go away. So how can we bring more people, but at the same time assuring that the values are there, that people don't come here just because it's fancy to buy organic products, or I don't know. Related to policies, would be great to see this, because all the financial supports from European Union that comes to agriculture in Portugal, they are really directed to the biggest farmers. So how can we influence these policies so that small agroecologic projects benefits from the financial supports? And also, in Portugal specifically, how can we make PGS acknowledged in among the policies and the legal stuffs? So this is it. What can we offer? We can offer a lot of things, mainly sharing our experiences. Liliana is engaged with the magnet, with the project. So I think but I'm talking about her, and she's not here, but she organized the training related to financial issues. So I think it was really, really, really important for the project. So I think it could be really, really nice and important to share what it was, the training and the results. And I think that's it.
Thank you so much, Felipe. Thank you. Manon? Allô?
Oui, est-ce que vous m'entendez?
Oui, oui.
OK. Yes. Du coup, nous, pour le Maroc, pour migration et développement, ce qu'on peut apporter, je pense, c'est toute la réflexion un peu sur l'action que l'on a, d'essayer de voir comment on formalise les apprentissages, comment on produit des connaissances à partir des expériences des paysans, des paysannes, les différents acteurs parties prenantes de nos projets. On a mis en place, on a développé pas mal de guides méthodologiques sur l'aménagement des bassins versants, sur les pratiques agroécologiques en milieu semi-aride, donc vraiment très adaptées à la situation, en tout cas, du Maroc. Voilà, donc toute cette question un peu de capitalisation et de voir de quelle manière on les utilise, on s'en sert pour faire un plaidoyer local, alors vraiment au niveau de la communauté. Et du coup, c'est peut-être le deuxième aspect qu'on pourrait aussi partager, c'est aussi l'approche un peu participative de transmission par les pairs. Comment on accompagne le changement entre pairs, entre personnes qui se ressemblent, et comment on adapte nos messages aux contraintes, aux difficultés ou aux forces ou aux réticences, enfin voilà, des différents acteurs. Donc peut-être ces deux aspects, réflexion sur l'action et accompagnement au changement. Après, sur les besoins, Rachida a déjà mis pas mal de points, donc je ne vais pas revenir dessus parce que sinon je prends du temps qu'on n'a pas beaucoup. Mais peut-être deux autres points, et je laisserai mes collègues, si nécessaire, me compléter. La première, c'est toutes les questions autour de la mise en place de SPG, système SPG, voilà, enfin... Nous, on va commencer dans le sud Maroc et voilà, c'est certainement des conseils, des orientations voilà, qu'il faudrait qu'on ait. Et puis après aussi, toute la question autour des protocoles de suivi, comment on modélise un peu les exploitations familiales pour démontrer la pertinence de l'application de l'agroécologie, pour voilà, donc toute cette question plus de suivi, évaluation et derrière de modélisation des différentes pratiques. Voilà, je crois que j'ai dit. Merci en tout cas.
Merci, merci beaucoup. I don't know if there anybody else wants to talk a little bit here and share. Sasha, how is our Miro?
It's I think it's doing good. Thanks for asking. I think me and Mila are handling the process.
I think also it's good that there is a recording. If this is recorded, mm-hmm. I think we stopped recording or?
No, we are recording.
The meeting is being recorded, yeah.
So we can go back and harvest because I think that we missed some things, certainly.
Yeah. I don't know if Anna, do you want to add anything else? Anna from DEFA.
I was turning on my microphone. Sorry. No, I think that we have, well, it's up to us, to the network who is here, to include more topics. But I think that I was taking also notes in my agenda because I'm not good with Miro. And I think that we have lots of inputs from all of you, both from needs and things that you can offer. I'm always impressed from these participatory video tools. I think that this thing is super innovative for me. However, I think that we have collected lots of information and needs and offers that can be shared within our project and can be included. And the biggest wish that we have, I guess, is to be able, or the biggest responsibility that we have, not wish, responsibility, is to be able to include both the needs and the offers in the process that we of the project. As Jocelyn said, the project is already running for 1 year, and then the following year, it is the heart of the project where we will identify, we will select, we will include all these topics in the three outputs that we have already introduced you, and I hope that we will be able to include to split them in the different issues. I guess that we will do that. I think I'm really happy with these inputs and for the partnership that is here for all of you that are including all topics.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, Marcia is with her hand raised.
Yes, that's it. Marcia.
Yes. So hi. I am new to this movement. I just found out about CSA some weeks ago. And I want to learn everything that I can because I always looked for something like this, people organizing around agroecology. So, and I also volunteer like some years ago, I took a sabbatical year and went to Italy, here in the UK, where I am, also France, also Sweden, went to several places looking for something like this. But at the time, nobody was connected to CSAs or any of these organizations' urgency. So now I'm very happy to have found you. I'm very glad to see that you are so organized. I'm also amazed with the tools. And regarding this, and specifically regarding these suggestions, so I have two suggestions because my need that I feel now is like I'm really eager and looking forward to be active, to contribute, to collaborate. And I'm also not linked to the UK. I can, and I wish to visit places in this region of the Mediterranean. So I'm suggesting that which is going to be also a way to finance yourselves, would be farming tourism, which is to offer weeks or days in which you can receive visitors, and then that would be a source of income for you. And it would be great for people like me that want to know your work locally.
Thank you so much. Yes, it's just that we are running out of time. Thank you much, Marcia. We have Ebru that wants to share also some shortly introduce the what are up in Festiye. I think.
Perfect pronunciation, and thank you for that. I will try to keep it short because I don't want to be the stalking person. I am aware of your movement through Ceyhan for quite some time. And although I'm originally from Ankara, I have been living in Fethiye, southwestern part of Turkey, very close to Crete Island and Rhodos Island, of course, closer. And I'm living in a partially rural area and in a village outer than Fethiye. So what I'm trying to say is right now here we have started the CSA local food community, let me say. Not all of the farmers are on the CSA framework in the sense that we do understand from that. But what I would like to say is the things are boiling. Because of the crisis, economic crisis, pandemic crisis, whatever, everybody finally understood that we need local food production. And all of the farmers here are aware of that. And what we are doing as people who have been in touch with, let me say, the world, other than the farmers here, we are trying to get organized. And we have a local community which we buy from producers, which we are trying to support their finances and so on and so forth. But we still need quite a lot of well thought of action to organize all the work here. Personally, I am a designer, an architect, not in the sense of serving the mainstream industry. I have been through some education on ecological design, both at Finhorn and in Tamera. I see that there are people here in Alentejo. And I have been trained on water retention landscapes and so I want to use all my design toolbox to the service of farms here to convert local small farms, small lands to more organized farms. So I think, I don't want to talk too much, but I just don't want to stay without any wording, because I have been listening all through the 2 hours, 2.5 hours, and I just wanted to give a voice and say hello, and want to make sure that you all know that I do here, me and my friends, very much appreciate what you are doing, and maybe, who knows, we will be part of your network too. Thank you very much. Görüşürüz. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Ebru. Thank you so much and for your kind words. So we are on time. It's 10:13 in your country. Jocelyn, so see, we have done our task in due time. So
that's wonderful.
Back to you.
Congratulations. We are really well organized, as has been said previously. That's very nice indeed. And well, maybe one thing I want to add, because I'm not sure if we mentioned it, but among the activities, well, Anna presented the activities. Some of them are face-to-face, but there are also activities which are podcasts and webinars where we definitely could involve you, and I mean, according to your skills and your topics. So especially the webinars, I think, would be great to highlight. We have the list now of what you've been working on, like, for example, the caravan of video shows in Tunisia, or I don't know, like this kind of experience would be really valuable to be shared, I think. Now we have half an hour left. Sorry, Anna, maybe you want to.
Yes, I wanted to say something, because a topic that came out from all the discussion was regarding the soil fertility that we already, because I totally forgot, yes, the webinars and podcasts, sorry, Jocelyn, for that, but I was okay in another mood. However, a topic that came out from all of you was the soil fertility, and actually our organization is facing the main topic is the soil fertility, and we were thinking to organize this webinar in Italian but also in English. So maybe we will really invite you to share, Ines and me. Ines, I remember that we decided to organize together the webinar in English on soil fertility. So yeah, maybe we will really be in touch with you, because this is a really a hot topic for the whole Mediterranean basin. And we will for sure contact you, because we will look for experiences and for successful experiences on keeping soil fertility, apart from the Portuguese and Italian ones that we already have that we want to share with you. But for sure, we will keep this as a central point regarding the farming practices, also the other things. But this is already came out among us. So thanks a lot.
Yes, and we already, I mean, we had a meeting just a couple of days ago, and we kind of started to decide on the topics for the webinars. We will send you a link to a chart where it will be possible to see the topic and the organizations who could be speaking or represented on each topic, so we can decide together how to do this webinar season. So the last part, I think it can be quite short, even if it's a bit of a challenge, because we already covered a lot of topics. Basically, this meeting is still part of a bigger symposium. And here we are also meeting as part of the Mediterranean region within the international movement of LSPA, so within Urgency. And next week, there will be the General Assembly of Urgency. And I think, as we did in Thessaloniki 3 years ago, I think it's important to come up with a list of, let's say, top priority actions Urgency should take for the Mediterranean region, for the Mediterranean network in the next years. So I'm going to share my screen. I think it will help a little bit just to go through the previous action plan we had for the Meds and to tell you really briefly where we are at, and then we can revise it with what has been said today and come up with very short action points. So I'm going to share my screen. Yep, how do I turn that into, sorry, I'm, yeah. You know, I'm transforming myself into a strange online creature, but still some things are a bit challenging for me, especially playing between different screens, two different screens. So here we go. So the action plan decided in Thessaloniki for the Meds, there was quite a long shopping list, but then fortunately, people from the group managed to say, come on, we have to just to identify key priorities. We have a color code. So green is done, orange is a work in progress, and red is missed. And the first one, I put red because basically what the group said 3 years ago was we need more coordination and more connections. And actually we, for different reasons, we didn't manage because of COVID, because it took time to submit the Medcar project and to have it gone through. And for different reasons, we didn't manage to have like proper face-to-face meetings. But of course, now we are resuming connections. So I'm less pessimistic than I was when I did this slide. Another aspect was sharing. So there were quite a lot of action points which were coming about sharing local experiences, sharing databases and inventory. I'm not sure what color is this one, but it's supposed to be orange. And what you see in the second column is really like the word per word what was said from the group in Thessaloniki. So I didn't change that. It was really labeled this way. So we said we should, that more support materials should be shared and translated. We should also identify how to implement contents, platforms. I'm not sure what we meant. I think the idea was to identify platforms where we can share materials. So definitely the Med Caravan can help us with that because we are going to have a participatory tool, especially for training materials to be shared. We said we need more, we need to share more local experiences. So almost nothing happened in this way, but once again, the project that is now taking speed will offer us the possibility to interact, not only face-to-face, but online. And we said also we need to share database and inventory. I think this is quite related to the first point about sharing training materials. Now we said something like we need to implement the training. Basically, the idea was we developed a training together, a training program with a training booklet and a guide for the trainers, and we need to get it implemented. And we heard that in Turkey it is being used, but in other countries I'm not completely sure how and whether it has been used. So I put it in, I think it's red or is it orange? And it's difficult actually for us to know whether these materials are actually being used. I think as we are resuming the connection, this will be clearer for us. Fundraising, we said we need to fundraise for joint projects. So I think we can say we did it because we got the Med Caravan project, but of course it's not perfect because we cannot include, we cannot involve really as full partners everyone. It's limited to a certain number of countries, but I think we can say that we managed to do a lot. And actually, as Anna said, it was clearly said we need to have a caravan project. It was labeled as a Mediterranean cross-border caravan to learn from people in villages. That's the way it was labeled 3 years ago. Of course, it's not completely that, it's a bit different, but I think what we are starting is still a realization of something that was designed initially by the group of people in Thessaloniki. And we also had the point about community supported fisheries, which has not been mentioned here, but basically like how to translate CSA into the world of fisheries and seafood. And now we have also a project on this dimension. So we did pretty well on this. And I think that's it for my slides. That were all the action plans we had to do, all the action points, yeah. And sorry, I think I have actually another one. Ah, yeah, sorry. I have another slide to show you, actually, it's very important. Some of you know it already, but I think most of you are not familiar with it. We have these, what we call the barn within urgency. Oh, sorry. Sorry. I thought I was fluent in virtual stuff, you know, after this week, but actually I see I still have big issues. So the strategic barn of urgency, the barn because, well, it looks like a barn, as you can see. And basically I'm showing this just to tell you that we have five main areas of work within urgency, and we really started from training, face-to-face experiences. So that's really the base of the barn. And then we started to build the barn with a very important element, which is advocacy. It's one of the sides of the roof. Advocacy, it means going to policymakers, addressing them. And to do so, we definitely need to research on our movement to give evidence, figures about what we are doing, our impact, social, environmental impact. So that's research. So we already have three dimension: training, advocacy, research. And on the left-hand side, we have movement building, which means basically network to network exchanges, like capacity building, tool sharing, and then mass mobilization campaigns, which has been mentioned by a couple of you as well during this call. I think these five areas are quite important to keep in mind when it comes to identify the key actions we want to have. Because what I'd like to do now as the final part would be to put in this urgency barn one top priority action for each of the dimensions that comes from the Mediterranean network. We don't need to go through a huge discussion because we have a lot of elements coming from the discussion we just had before. What we need to do is just to say, okay, regarding experience sharing, training, as the Mediterranean part of urgency, what is our need? What do we put our plate until the next symposium? And it should be brought on to the General Assembly. So it can be something like, I've heard about the issue of farming practices, like soil fertility, water resilience. Maybe there is a specific need for the Med to develop a training on soil fertility, water resilience, specific challenges that are specific to the Mediterranean area to be offered to all the CSA farmers involved in urgency. I think I need somebody to help me with taking notes on Miro, maybe with a new post-it. Or actually, sorry, I prepared something. I forgot about it. Sorry. And please jump in as I'm speaking, because it should be over there. Yeah, here. This is the last chart, Miro chart for today, I swear you.
We love Miro.
You love Miro, perfect.
Yeah.
So top priority action. So I don't know, I propose something that's part of what I heard, but it can be something different. I don't know who wants to agree or not. Is there a different kind of need?
I would just like to jump in for a moment, least from part of the needs of our organization. What I would really love to see is a fully agroecological farm. How is it in practice dealing with all the issues? You know, not just isolated topics, water management, soil fertility, but you know, the whole complete picture of agroecological farm. How is it working in every aspect? So that would be really something useful for us.
But also, I think that Denis from France mentioned it, or someone else, I'm not sure. I found it really wonderful to hear farm diversity. So it's not in a way, it's not one way that something is correct and well functioning and so on, but there are different ways, like in nature, to deal with the problems and life and obstacles. So not to think of it as one, only one possible system. So if there are two-
Diversity of models, okay, yeah.
Yes. I think that opens up our imagination also in front of problems.
Okay, I think Denis raised the hand, no? Maybe not anymore. Ah yes.
Oui, tout à fait, oui. C'était pour rebondir un peu sur la discussion, j'ai bien compris que ce qui ressort là, du réseau méditerranéen, je le comprends parfaitement, c'est, on va dire, l'appui technique, l'agroécologie, les semences paysannes, avec tout ce qui concerne, je dirais, l'appui technique. Et je comprends très bien pourquoi, pour un ensemble de pays où c'est vraiment une question prioritaire de former les gens et les fermes. En France, on a un système un peu différent parce qu'au niveau de nos réseaux d'AMAP, en fait, à côté, Evelyne l'a noté, on a un ensemble de réseaux d'organisations paysannes qui assurent l'appui technique. C'est-à-dire, nous, au niveau des AMAP, on n'a pas vraiment, on a affaire à des professionnels, des gens qui savent produire en agriculture biologique ou en agroécologie. Et nos besoins de formation sur le plan technique, c'est plutôt de les conduire vers le partenariat avec les consommateurs. Par contre, moi, je l'ai mis dans la discussion, il y a quelque chose que je voudrais faire émerger au niveau du réseau méditerranéen. On en avait parlé en 2018 à Thessalonique. En fait, ce qui nous réunit, je suis persuadé qu'on ne peut pas modifier les politiques agricoles industrielles en agissant sur le plan de la politique agricole. La réalité, c'est qu'on modifie les politiques agricoles par la consommation des ménages. C'est ce qui s'est passé en France et en Europe avec l'agriculture bio. Il n'y a aucun gouvernement réellement en Europe qui a décidé de favoriser la bio. C'est parce que les consommateurs ont commencé à manger en bio que les autorités politiques ont été obligées de venir. Et moi, je voudrais qu'on mette en avant, ce que je veux dire, c'est que c'est le modèle alimentaire qui va modifier qui peut modifier le modèle agricole. Et on a avec nous, là on le voit en Provence, nous, mais pas qu'en Provence, aussi bien au niveau des États, c'est coincé, c'est-à-dire le modèle agricole industriel est dominant, on le voit dans la politique agricole commune en Europe, mais autant au niveau des collectivités plus locales dans les territoires, les élus, les autorités politiques locales sont sensibles aux questions d'alimentation. Et moi je voudrais qu'on mette en avant ce qui nous réunit tous aussi au niveau méditerranéen sur le plan culturel, historique, anthropologique, c'est la diète méditerranéenne. En tant qu'alternative à la malbouffe, on a un outil culturel formidable qui est la diète méditerranéenne qui permet effectivement que les familles se réapproprient l'alimentation. Et là, il faut demander des circuits courts et retravailler sur l'alimentation des familles. J'aimerais bien qu'on mette
ça du coup. Et du coup, Denis, ça, tu mettrais où ? Est-ce que c'est du plaidoyer ou est-ce que c'est plutôt de la mobilisation de masse, on va dire, enfin, arriver à avoir de nouvelles populations qui consomment de manière agroécologique ? Je ne sais pas, qui consomment des produits agroécologiques ?
Je pense déjà que nos consommateurs en AMAP, ils préparent les produits en cuisine. Hein. On se remet en cuisine avec les AMAP et le système CSA. Oui, tu as raison, c'est au niveau advocacy, donc plaidoyer, et ça fait partie du volet social et culturel. C'est-à-dire que l'idée de la caravane, pour moi, elle doit aussi porter les échanges, les pratiques culinaires à des familles.
D'accord.
C'est un modèle alternatif à la malbouffe. C'est-à-dire, le problème aujourd'hui des populations en précarité, c'est l'obésité, c'est les diabètes, c'est les produits hyper sucrés, hyper transformés, hyper salés. Et là, on a un outil formidable au sein de nos mouvements pour promouvoir une alimentation de qualité qui elle-même va pouvoir permettre de changer le modèle de production agricole. Enfin, c'est un pari, hein, voilà, mais je le fais.
Merci.
Je voulais juste rajouter sur ce que Denis il a dit, parce que si on ne veut pas appeler ça du plaidoyer, mais si on veut au moins éduquer les consommateurs, en fait, même si on a tous beaucoup de connaissances, c'est des messages très simplifiés qu'il faut pouvoir donner pour pouvoir ensuite aboutir à une conversation importante autour du système agricole. Donc, des fois, c'est facilité par oui, partager une recette ensemble ou même manger ensemble ou par le modèle de tourisme qu'on est en train de faire. C'est au moins qu'il y ait un paiement pour ça. Et de vraiment avoir des messages simples parce que des fois, on est très théorique, très académique et tout le monde aime le modèle quand on en parle, mais qu'est-ce que ça veut dire en tant que prendre un premier pas? Mais au moins, il y a un intérêt plutôt que de parler de ça et les gens, ils ont peur de prendre des risques ou ils n'ont pas de confiance en des paysans ou ils n'ont pas le temps. Merci beaucoup.
Merci, Laura. OK. Très bien. Donc j'ai rajouté cet aspect l'aspect culinaire.
Tu peux dire un mot, Jocelyn?
Oui, bien sûr, Evelyne. Il y a aussi, je crois que Tanguy aussi a levé la main. Ah, vas-y, pardon. Evelyne.
Oui, bonjour tout le monde. C'était pour aller dans ce sens. Je pense que les élus, enfin les politiques, ils sont sourds tant qu'il n'y a pas un mouvement d'opinion. Et je pense que ce qui est important, c'est de développer un mouvement d'opinion en faisant connaître ce qu'on fait. Je pense qu'effectivement, choisir son alimentation, c'est un acte politique, c'est un choix qui induit beaucoup de choses. Il faut faire des événements, il faut convoquer des journalistes, il faut faire des articles dans les journaux, faire changer l'opinion. Et là, les élus écoutent, parce que l'opinion, c'est des électeurs. Et on a beaucoup plus de pouvoir, comme disait Denis, sur le municipal, le plus proche, le local, le régional, puisqu'on a vu, on n'a aucun poids pour changer la PAC. Et la PAC est totalement hostile, enfin opposée à ce qu'on fait. Mais je crois que voilà, développer des mouvements d'opinion avec tous les moyens qu'on a, des fêtes, des fermes ouvertes, des événements, j'ai dit.
Pardon, merci, c'est noté. Du coup, j'ai deux mains levées. J'ai Tanguy et puis Sunshana.
Je voulais lancer. Je voulais attirer l'attention sur, moi j'ai un peu plus le regard par rapport aux acteurs du Sud dans le réseau méditerranéen, et je voulais attirer l'attention sur le fait qu'il y a un enjeu un petit peu pour professionnaliser les acteurs du Sud qui travaillent sur la thématique de l'agroécologie. C'est-à-dire qu'aujourd'hui, on a la chance d'avoir plusieurs structures qui sont conscientes des enjeux et des challenges. Malheureusement, c'est beaucoup fait à partir de bénévolat dans ces associations-là. Et si on veut être ambitieux et se donner les moyens, il y a des enjeux pour comment on trouve des fonds, comment on professionnalise ces structures, comment on peut payer les gens qui font ce travail-là. Donc, c'est un vrai enjeu pour qu'on puisse avancer. Comment ces structures peuvent s'organiser, peut-être un petit peu s'autofinancer. Voilà, il y a un vrai challenge là-dessus pour se donner les moyens de nos ambitions. Et puis, deuxième point que je voulais vous partager, c'est important de se rencontrer, d'avoir des temps ensemble. On a vu ce que ça a pu donner à travers les rencontres ensemble. Jocelyn, tu vois, ces différents voyages d'échange ont impulsé des vraies dynamiques, je pense, qui aujourd'hui nous portent encore. Et donc, nous, à Terre Humanisme, on a des fonds pour organiser une rencontre en 2022, plutôt au sud de la Méditerranée, parce que nos fonds sont orientés comme ça. Donc voilà, là, je lance un appel à voir comment on peut organiser ça, qui aurait envie d'accueillir une rencontre interacteur et voir comment on pourrait faire les liens entre nous, notre réseau donc plutôt arabophone sur le sud, et voir quel lien avec la rive d'en face au nord de la Méditerranée, voir comment peut-être inviter une personne ou deux pour créer des ponts et des liens entre nos réseaux. Voilà, c'est tout pour moi.
Merci, super. Et Urgency, à travers la caravane méditerranéenne de l'agroécologie, encore une fois, a un petit peu de fonds pour pouvoir inviter des personnes de la rive sud vers la rive nord. Voilà, je crois qu'on a déjà... Ah, Sunshana, pardon. Sunshana, à toi.
Oh, thank you. Well, I wanted to say something else. While we were talking, I was thinking about these advocacy issues. I understand that not many people are willing to participate in advocacy because it's truly annoying. It's like really a lot of effort and with very seems like a very small result. But on the other hand, I see really like a problem that decisions about farmers are made without farmers themselves. And also like, if you wanna have a CSA group and anything you wanna do, you have to comply with the laws that are not made for us. And we have very often problems to adjust our systems to the rules that we have. So we always need to find some kind of things in between and some kind of ways how to avoid all these crazy unlogic rules that we have. And I think it's very important to also to work with farmers to teach them how to participate in advocacy. It's like it's not they will not it's hard to imagine that farmers will organize campaigns on their own and work on this because it's they don't have these resources. They need to work on the land, but at least if somebody organized campaign, they should be some kind of informed and sensitive about it, like so they have just basic tools how to get involved into it and how to say their attitudes and how we can after that work on bringing those attitudes to policymakers. I think it's also important thing to do.
Thank you, Sunshana. It was like a remark about advocacy, but I don't take like a new action, right? Or should I add a post-it, you think, there?
So, well, sort of, I don't know. I was thinking
like
how
support.
To do it. Like, but it's just for a future. My idea was maybe to create some kind of a training for farmers to how to get involved in the campaigns, how to get some basic knowledge. So I don't have a really clear picture about it, how it's going to look like. We want to develop it for our national level, but then we can share it. But it's
the so future. It's like, I don't have it. It's like a training for advocacy / campaigning for agroecological farmers, basically.
Yeah, for farmers, like how can we...
Okay.
Make our voice to be heard, sort of.
Great. Okay. D'accord. So actually, we don't need to have like a shopping list of actions. So I feel we are pretty good already, except if somebody feels like we're really missing something. Of course, I will try to clean these action points just a little bit so we can... They can be presented during the General Assembly of Urgency. The General Assembly will be 2nd and 3rd of November online as well. So it's next week. There will be a change from summertime to wintertime in quite a few countries. So be careful if you want to join the General Assembly to be on the right time. And yeah, I think we did pretty well. I really like, some ideas, all the ideas were really great and some are very concrete. I like it very much, like developing cooking sessions I think it goes well with the issue of accessibility, which has been one issue we touched upon during the Med Caravan project management meeting we had a couple of days ago. Or weeks ago. So I think a lot of this, what has been said here, goes very well with the project. I hope everybody's fine with what we've done. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so everybody can see each other. And maybe to close the round, because it's time now to close. I don't know what to do. I didn't prepare any icebreaker. It's not icebreaker, but a kind of closing exercise. Does somebody have an idea?
Nothing in the in not no tool for that. You don't have like
not a mirror tool this time.
A mirror something tool else. For ice breaking.
Just one.
Yes, Philippa.
I heard that during these meetings in organized by urgency, in some of them they proposed that all the people might have a vegetable or a tool in their hands. So maybe we can say goodbye like that.
Ah, nice. So I have to go and get my veggie. I don't know if you all have a veggie or kitchen tool. So go get one and we say goodbye. We can take a group picture. So everybody to get either a kitchen tool or a vegetable back in 20 seconds.
Can it be a fruit or it has to be a vegetable?
Yeah, it can be a fruit, no problem. Wait a second. I have to get my background off.
Sasha, I know what you're eating. Do you know where this came from? Remember? Yeah. I think this was yours, Sasha.
We did yesterday night, Ines.
Let me do something which will help for the picture. Tanguy, you don't have anything at hand? Ah, yeah, great. Ebru, do you have something?
Unfortunately, I don't have anything because I'm in my little working space for the moment. I have no fruit, so unfortunate.
Ah, what a pity.
What a pity. Maybe I'll take another plant, something.
Ah, sorry. Just hold on for a while. Denis, je te vois pas avec quoi que ce soit. Nice. I think there is a limit to the number of people I can put, yeah. I can pin. So I have to do this way. Wait. A second, sorry. I know some of you are bearing quite heavy ones. But sorry, wait a second. And now a smile. Great. A second one, just to make sure. A second. I'm sorry. The last
it's
one.
It's a big soup. It's a big soup.
Exactly. The last one, the last picture. Up. Yeah. A different angle. Crazy you. Up. And are still there. This is really the last one for true. Wonderful. Thank you so much. I think we are done.